Hi, this is Doug White, and this is episode 3 of Secure Digital Life 3. And I'm here with Russ Boschman again, and we're here to talk to you about things that affect you, that affect your life, security, and how security is going to impact you. It's like a self-help program for hacking. Right.
Awesome.
Or
yeah.
It's a recovery program or something like that. It's like I'm an addict. Like, I can't stop using technology.
My name is Russ and I'm an addict.
Hi, my name's Doug. And I can't quit using my phone and I can't stop or whatever you happen to be looking at. Oh, you want me to touch that? Oh, I did. Yeah. So, welcome to Secure Digital Life. And you type in AAA porn or whatever it is you're typing in. I'm sorry. I was at a PG show.
And I'm really excited to be here.
I'm glad you're here because somebody needs to know what's going on.
That's right.
Okay. So now
somebody has to drink this.
It's another day. It's another episode.
Yeah. He's looking at the wrong camera.
You put my camera over here. Cut. Basically forget you ever saw that. I think actually forgetting you ever saw that would really be a good idea at this point. So, okay, what we're going to talk about this week is we want to talk about paranoia, my favorite thing, because I love paranoia because I get paid to be paranoid. I was a disaster recovery planning person, and they like me because they would bring me in the building, and everybody else is going, ooh, isn't that pretty? And I'm going, what if that fell on people? Like, wouldn't that be a horrible mess? Like, I was literally looking at this thing one time in this atrium, and they were all talking about how nice the atrium was, and I was like, if that fell, it would just squish everybody that's having coffee. And they're like, whoa, what's wrong with you? And I was like, I don't know, but I'm not sitting under that thing. But that's what disaster recovery planning was about. So we want to talk a little bit about websites because everybody goes to websites all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some of us are probably going to websites right now. Like Russ has got a phone in his pocket. I can tell.
And a watch.
Yeah, and he's like touching his iPhone watch, the whole time. Going to websites, doing that website stuff. Tweeting or whatever you're going to. But when you go to these things, a lot of times information starts getting requested from you. And we wanted to talk a little bit about what is pushing and pulling and getting data from you. And it kind of all comes back to cons, which is something I've always been fascinated with because I love scams and cons and all those kind of things. And so we wanted to talk a little bit about it. One of the things we wanted to talk about was the fact that the internet is based around a protocol that is clear text. And that means that when the internet was designed, and remember the internet was designed back in the 1970s. I mean, the DARPA agency, or the Department of Defense, built the internet back in the 70s. And they based all this stuff around these protocols that they designed. And at the time, that was all there was. And so everything literally is being sent in this format. Even if it's video, it's really being sent in these types of format. Now, there's ways to encapsulate it, and there's all kinds of fancy things that we can do. But most of the things that you're doing on the internet, whether you're reading a news article on the Washington Post or on Fox News, we won't get into politics. This show has no political leanings. We are politically neutral. But or not, but that's too bad. But the idea of that was that all this stuff is sent in the clear, plain mm-hmm. text. Mm-hmm. So you want to tell people about HTTP, or you have a comment on that?
HTTP, so basically how the internet works is any kind of digital document, item, file, whatever, is broken down into component parts called packets, or frames, if you want to also.
I like packets.
All right, we're going with packets. So if you think about what that means is like all matter is broken down into atoms, right? The smallest part of matter, well, at least, the smallest whole part of matter, and
quarks.
Atoms.
No,
yeah, atoms
quarks.
Atoms have electrons,
gluons.
Protons, neutrons, yeah, and so on and so
gluons
forth.
Gluons and gluons and quarks.
Anyway,
and
the information that's transmitted over the internet is broken up into packets, and those packets are sent through a protocol known as TCP/IP, or Transmission Control Protocol over Internet Protocol. So, and TCP/IP, HTTP is a hypertext transfer protocol, which happens over TCP, and it uses a specific port known as port 80.
Right.
And so those packets are broken up from the web page or from the website, and then they're sent and received through TCP/IP over port 80. So that's broken down.
And so HTTP then is just a plain text protocol. I mean, so every web page you look at, if you've ever noticed, if you look up there on the bar, I'm going to do a demo for you in a little bit. But if you look up there on the bar, you'll see that HTTP, and that means it's using that protocol to send and receive that information. So all that's sent in the clear. And that's a bit of a problem for a lot of people, because if you start thinking about, and I've been around a while, so if you go back in the early days of the internet, people started asking the question, and I started getting calls where they were saying, how dangerous is this? Yeah. What if I want to buy something on the internet? And usually they were buying something like dirty. You could always tell, because like, what if my friend wanted to buy something on the internet? And back then there was nothing on the internet at all.
Except
unlike today.
Porn.
Yeah, there was just porn. Unlike today where there's just porn. But people started getting worried about that. And then you start to see news articles. So you'd see something on you know, CNN or somebody would have a story about the dangers of the internet. And so what happened was, more protocols got involved.
Yep.
So there is something in the world that I have to explain to you, unfortunately. This is called public key encryption or hybrid key encryption. And what happens is, because you need to go to something and there's no way for you to exchange keys. So it's just like going to a person's house. And the best example of this is like Airbnb. So I always use Airbnb. If you don't know what that is, and they owe me now, I get a free night or something for that. No, I'm just kidding. But Airbnb or any of these kind of like apartment sharing places.
Couchsurfer, yeah.
Yeah, any of those, which are super cool. I like them. I stay in those things all the time, and you get these awesome places to stay. But they have to have a way to give you the key to this place. Unlike a hotel where you go to the front desk, or a friend where they mail you a key and regret it for the rest of their life, or your house where you have a key, these are strangers coming to this location. So an Airbnb has to have some kind of mechanism to give you a key. So sometimes it's a person. Sometimes a really weird person.
I had a
couple of really weird people that got out of like really weird cars. I'm like, oh, is he going to kill me? And then he's like, no, here's the key. And I was like, oh, okay, thank you. Other times they have a lockbox.
Yep.
Sometimes it's something weird, like you go to a bar and order a VPN. Remember last week we did the VPN drink? You go to the bar and order a VPN or ask for Russ, and they give you a key, and you get this key. But somehow websites have to give you a key so that you can share encryption. So it's like a secret code game. So what they do is they have this thing called public key encryption. And what happens is that there's a public part of the key and a private part of the key. So the website can only decrypt what is sent to it. So it's encrypted publicly, but only with the secret key can you decrypt it. So it's, again, Airbnb is the best example of public key encryption. It's like when you stay in a condo and they have that, you know, that mystery room that you really want to pick the lock to. I don't know if you ever stay in a condo, like Airbnbs always have, you know, they got that locked room and it's like
go in there.
It's like Bluebeard, you know, it's like you can go in any room in my house,
except for that one.
So of course, which room do you want to get in? You know, it's lock picks and crowbars and flexible cameras. There was another one. You've got like a flexible camera. You can put it under the door and see what's up under there.
Oh my God.
And I always thought if I had one of those places, I would rig that room to be absolutely terrifying. So if people were looking under there, they picked the lock.
Yeah.
You got like all this like imagery in there, and they're like, oh my God, there's like jars with heads of them in this closet. And of course, that's how you get in jail. But so what happens is by using that public key encryption, back to the point, that's which is really tough for me. If you're using public key encryption, I use a certificate, and that certificate allows me to use a protocol called HTTPS. Mm-hmm. Now, you remember last week we were talking about VPNs and how stuff can get wrapped up in encryption. HTTPS does the same thing. So now the information that's being sent over the internet with HTTPS is actually wrapped up in encryption, just like those VPN packets were doing that Russ showed you with the VPN drink last week. Mm-hmm. So the very same thing is going on. So that means if you go to a website and you're using HTTPS, and you can, and again, in my demo, you get to see that. But if you do that, you can tell kind of what's going on in terms of how secure the site is and whether or not you should submit any information to it. Because if it's not encrypted, you do not know how many hops are between you and the other end of this thing. So if you go to the BBC.com, I think I used that in my demo, you will see that there's a bunch of hops in between me and you. So what we're going to do then, is talk a little bit about what you should never submit on the internet. And you want to tell them some stuff you should never submit?
Sure. So, and while we're talking about this, I might as well mention I just got an email yesterday from my bank, or supposedly from my bank, ooh, saying, hey, you've been approved for a $165,000 loan at just $400 a month at 3.8%. And the problem is it's for a homeowner's loan. Well, I don't own a home, so I'm not sure, you know, that immediately clued me, like, something's going on here. It's weird stuff. So I look at the email, and of course it's not from XYZ Bank. It's from, you know, XYZ GFA Bank, you know.
Right.
And so we know that that's one of the things I bet you
talked about on episode one. We talked about phishing attacks and how we could have these link checks.
So things that you should not submit over the internet that you're not 100% sure of are things like bank account numbers, social security numbers, to some extent birth date, depending on the context in which it's being sent. You know, if it's with other information such as names, dates, address, or names, addresses, kids' names, you know, social security numbers. You want to make sure that you're not submitting a complete archive or record for anybody to easily be able to guess who you are.
And I call it a push-pull problem, because if somebody's asking you for things, that's to me a lot scarier and creepier than when I'm offering something.
Sure.
So if I go to a website and I've evaluated it, and like it's the state of Rhode Island, whatever, or it's the state of New York, or whatever state you went to, and they need some information from you, and I logged into their site, and I'm looking at it, and I feel like, okay, this is a legitimate site, I'm a lot more inclined to give up a piece of information than when somebody contacts me asking for that piece of information. Like, one that you get all the time that drives me up the wall is social security number.
Mm-hmm.
I hate it when people ask me for my social security number, because you're not supposed to use that. It's illegal.
Yep.
The federal government only allows it to be used for social security and governmental purposes. So you'll see this, and used to every doctor's office, every dentist's office, the universities, everybody use social security numbers as an identifier, and they've all sort of slowly stopped. But I remember years ago when I worked at a university, I went in and they said to get your paycheck, you had to write your social security number on a sheet of paper, and it was on a counter in plain sight, and there was all these people's names and social security numbers. So I don't like to give up that. And the other thing I don't like to give up is combinations of things.
Yep.
Because when the more they get, the more I get nervous when they're saying, oh, give me this and this and this and this and this. And so really that's where I start to get nervous is when they're starting to ask me for lots and lots of things. But again, you have to function. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like security being that thing where they say, how secure is it? Mm-hmm. And nothing is perfect.
Right.
So you could lock yourself inside of a vault and never go out and be sort of Howard Hughes and, you know, and pee in jars and all this stuff that guy was doing. Or you can try to function in the real world. So we're going to show you a demo then of me showing you some of these websites and what they look like so you can identify those same problems. And I did this on a screenshot, so you don't need to look at my beautiful self. You'll have to look at my beautiful screen. Okay? So we'll let you see that right now.
We were talking about HTTP and HTTPS and stuff you should and shouldn't put on the internet. Well, it's a tough call, because every time you use a website, some information about you is being collected. And I mean, you can, and we're going to do a show one day about using Tor and some of these hide me kind of applications. But right now, we're just talking about for average users that you're at home. And honestly, it's very difficult, at least in my experience, to constantly try to hide yourself. I know you should. I know you want to. It's a basic component of hacker mentality that you should never be seen. But it's very, very difficult to keep that up on a day-to-day basis, because we use this thing that you're looking at right here constantly. So in that regard, assuming we're going to use it and we're not going to completely disguise ourselves, you can look at a few things and start making determinations about how much risk you have on a site. So for instance, hey, look at this site, bbc.com. Now, between me and the server, I don't know how many devices exist on the internet. But this, because it does not, and I'll show you a different one in a minute, because it does not say HTTPS, what that means is that this is sent HTTP. That means every piece of information on this page is sent in the clear. That means anything that it touches, and there's probably at least 7 or 8 hops between me and this BBC server. There's probably one in New York or Boston or somewhere, so I'm getting that. But there's still at least 3 or 4 hops. Every one of those, my data could be intercepted. Now, this is the BBC. I'm here to read the news. I'm not submitting any information. So that means all this stuff being sent to Clear is their information. I don't care about their information. If people want to sniff and grab BBC stuff as it's being sent to me, who cares? I didn't give them anything. So as it stands, this is just a perfectly reasonable site. Now, you see this little eye, and these can be different in different browsers. This is Google Chrome. That little eye right there means that this website is not certified. They did not pay for a security certificate that indicates that this is BBC.com. And you can click on this and see all this information about it, and you see it says it's not secure. So this little warning is telling you, and you can just keep your eyes peeled for this. I don't worry about it until the point where I start giving them something. Now I'm going to scroll up to the top real quick. And you can see there's a sign-in page. I'm going to click sign-in. Now look what just happened. When I went to sign in, everything changes. Now, if I sign in right here on BBC, I'm sending something to them. And that something would be my email address or my username that I've paid for a subscription and my password. Yikes. I'm sending something that's very critical. And we talked about those different passwords, or we're going to talk about them. I don't know if we talked about them yet in the show. But if you're using a password here, you don't want to be using a password somebody could grab. But this is being sent HTTPS. You see it right there. That means that at the very least, and nothing is secure. Nothing is ultimately secure. But at the very least, your password and your username is going to be sent encrypted to the BBC. So that means if there's a sniffer, if there's somebody sitting out there on the internet at one of those hops watching what you're sending, at least that information is being sent encrypted over the internet. It also has changed to secure. So you see that Chrome has detected now that this is a secure connection. That means they're using a certificate, and that means that that certificate appears to be valid. And what it means is they've registered all this and they put that out there so that it appears to be valid. I see the sun must be going down because my screen color is changing. Hang on. If you don't use Flux, well, I do. I'm going to turn this off so that we'll get normal colors for a while. You don't want to see my Flux screen. It changes it so that it's more yellow. It's really cool. I like it. But anyway, you see the difference in those two sites. Let's look at a different one. Here's a Cisco site. I'm already logged into this site, so I'm actually inside of a secure site. Same thing, secure. That means there's a certificate in place. All the transactions between these pages are being sent back and forth with encryption in place. HTTPS is in use. Let's try another one. Citizens Financial Group. Here's Citizens, and I don't actually have an account at Citizens, so don't get excited. But now you see that it's got the certificate information up here. It's still green. It's got the padlock. That means that this is encrypted information. I just went to their basic login page for Citizens Bank. And Citizens Financial Group, Citizens, you owe me for this. And you can see, again, HTTPS. That means that this information is at least being encrypted between you and their server, and that you have at least some assurance that the server is who you think it is. And you remember that last week we talked about phishing attacks, and I showed you some examples of sites that didn't have these kind of things. Here's one again. Here's a site, Roger Williams, and on the Roger Williams site, you see that once again, we're back to HTTPS. We're back to this unsecured. This means Roger Williams doesn't have a secure certificate on this site. Well, why do they want to pay for that? Makes no sense, really, because you're not going to give them anything here. You're just here to get information. So you're looking at their material. If you switch over to some part of Roger Williams where you need to log in, you're going to see that that's going to switch over to an HTTPS site as well. So to sum it up very quickly, what you're looking for is you're looking for a green padlock. Even better, there's a name right here. So Cisco didn't have one. Citizens has one. That means in their certificate, the name matches as well. So it's called Citizens Financial Group. And you should read that and say, does that make any sense? Or does this say something like, you know, Guyana, you know, technical something? And you're going, why would that doesn't match at all? And Thirdly, you're looking for HTTPS, but only when you're sending information. Don't get overly paranoid. When you're just reading, so what? Their information is sent to clear, but they're giving you that information anyway. So who cares? It doesn't make any difference. So don't get crazy with it, because then it's just pointless. We'll talk some other time about the stuff you need to worry about behind the scenes. But citizens, well, on our list here, citizens has a pretty solid one. And we've got a green padlock, we've got the name of the company, and we got HTTPS all showing up there at the top. Cyber at Roger Williams, well, they don't have any of it because who cares? They don't really need it. BBC, they have it when you want to sign in. If you go back to the just regular old BBC page, it's wide open and nobody really cares. I'm trying to keep political stuff off the page because it doesn't matter. We're not here to talk about politics. So you can see there's three different kinds of sites that are available to you. When you send personal information, be sure you know what you're sending and be sure that you know who you're sending it to. So you want to see those things right there. And there's other ways you can make this more sophisticated if you feel like you need to. All right?
All right. So there you go. There's a demo of some different things that you could look for. And these are just little things. I mean, obviously, if you want to get into like heavy security and you want to get into panic security, you might want to watch Security Weekly or Hack Thinking News or some of those shows and really start upping your game. But this is just some basic stuff that you ought to be doing when you use the internet, because and it's easy not to. I mean, without a doubt, we all do it. You do this, you click on one site. And another thing I wanted to talk about a little bit was what I call cross-site contamination. Do you know what that means? Have you ever heard me say that before?
I don't think I have
okay.
heard you say
well,
that
that's
before.
That's okay. I'll let you prompt me to say it. I love attention. What I call cross-site contamination is where you're on a website and there's a link to another website. Mm-hmm. And it's very easy to embed websites within websites within websites. So you have to be careful when you're on, and it's even worse today. I mean, because they have so much content scattered around the edges. So everybody's been there and you've accidentally hit the clickbait, or you intentionally hit the clickbait. But one of the things you have to be careful about is if you get in this kind of I'm going to be careful mindset, which you should, and you're looking at CNN and you accidentally have your mouse sitting on the edge of the screen and you click it, something new pops up. Is it BuzzFeed? Is it some other kind of clickbait stuff? And you end up on a website that maybe now is very questionable.
Yeah.
And so I get a little more worried about that, and it's easy to do. So that's one kind of cross-site contamination. And the other is where it's possible to actually link to a different site from the site you thought you were on. So you're on CNN, and you click this link, and it takes you to a registration page. Always be looking at that the bar. Yep. What am I on? Am I on CNN, or did I go off to some other destination? Who knows what it is? And so when you're seeing that, you're not seeing the green padlock now, right. And you don't have to panic when you don't see a green padlock, as we saw in the demo. But when you're looking and you're seeing HTTP, or you're seeing no padlock, and all of a sudden you're like on a non-certificate, non-registered site, you have to think a little bit about that. And the other thing I like to talk about is passwords. What do you do for passwords, Russ?
So for passwords, now that I've gotten increasingly more aware of security needs and requirements, I have increased the complexity of my passwords. It used to be where I didn't care, and I used one password for everything.
Yeah.
That is not working any longer for me because it's just not secure. And if somebody grabs that password, you know, God forbid, you know, something happened. You know, last week I was telling you about the open Wi-Fi in the casino that I was staying at CES.
Right.
If somebody was just sniffing, you know, and I wasn't using the VPN, if somebody was just sniffing,
right,
they could have grabbed my password and then had access to everything.
Yep.
So I stopped that, and now now there are different levels of passwords that I use.
Well, so I'll give you my levels, and here's what I found in all my like pen tests and all these things. People use the same password.
Mm-hmm.
They log into the front of the company, and they've got a pin number they type in. It's the same as their password. It's the same as their phone pin and all these things. And here's the problem. The more complexity you add to this, the more likely you are to screw it up.
Yep.
And you're going to write it down on a card in your wallet or something, and it's just all completely worthless. But I do have... And I'm going to give them to you. I'm going to share them with you for free. You got to watch them. I mean, look, can you believe it? For free, my four levels of passwords that I use. And so level one is this is the lowest level of password. I call these strays. Stray passwords are throwaways.
Mm-hmm.
So if I go to a website, like this afternoon, I go to a website and they want me to log in. and create an account just so I can read an article, or I can look at a picture, or I can watch a video or something. And I don't mean YouTube or something like that. I mean just some stray site. Yeah. I'm probably never going to go to that website again. I use a stray pad. I have a list, and they're not very hard passwords. I don't care if you crack it. I'm not giving you anything good. I even have a stray email for this. Mm-hmm. So I have a stray email account that I created on one of my domains, and I use that as a throwaway. So it's just, boom, I log in. I log in as this guy, and I use this lame password, and forget it. I don't care if somebody cracks it because I've never given anything there. Every piece of information I give them is fake. Okay, so that's my level one password, and I have a whole list of those, and I just rotate them around. I don't care very much. Then I have what I call commons. These are level two passwords. These are sites you go to regularly. You may need to remember the passwords for. You need a strong password. And we're going to have a show about password creation. That may be the next show, actually. We're going to have a show about how to use password vaulting. Yeah. I think we don't have enough time today to get into like password vaulting and strong passwords. But you want to create a decent password for this. So that means it's got at least six or seven characters. It's got some symbols, numbers, and it's a mixture of case or whatever. But I have some of those, and I have something in my head that I know, and I'm not going to tell you, that I remember that lets me remember what these passwords are. Mm-hmm. And I do use them on more than one site. So it might be for my password for CNN is the same as my password for Washington Post is the same. But I try not to let them propagate too far.
Sure.
So if I've got one I use on YouTube and CNN and all these things, so somebody's going to get hacked eventually, and they're going to get that password, and then I have to change it. Mm-hmm. So whenever you get the notice, you're going to have to go through and say changes. So you may want to keep up with it. Then I got level three. I call these serious passwords. And serious passwords are things that can hurt you. So I use serious passwords, which are really nasty. So these are pass phrases. Mm-hmm. So now I'm actually using phrases out of books that I know. You're never going to figure out what these are because they don't make any sense. They're not common stuff like 4 score and 7 years ago. That's not one, so don't even waste your time.
It was a dark and stormy night.
It was a dark and stormy. Yeah, it's like, Romeo, oh, Romeo. No, I use things that I remember for some strange reason. They don't make any sense. So they're collections of words that I can remember for some odd reason. And you may have to have a password vault manager to do these. Mm-hmm. But these are serious. I put these on anything where I think it would hurt me. So a bank. And I don't reuse them. So they're one-shot deals. Mm-hmm. And so I would never use my bank password on another site for any reason whatsoever. I use them on my stock trading account. So if I've got a stock trading account, I use it there. I use it on my credit card account. So these are all serious things because if somebody got that, they could get in there and they could take money out of my account. And that's what I call a series. And then I have one other level of password, and you'd think the banks would be in that level. Yeah. But the other level I don't even use is called launch codes. And my level four passwords are ones that need to be so serious that you probably have to have some kind of computer-generated assistance to remember them. And this would be for something that would be the end of the world if it was compromised. So if you have something like that, share it with us. We'd love to hear. But send it in and tell us what it is. But this, I call this the launch code paragraph. Some people do have things like this. Some people do have things that they feel would be the end of their world if it was compromised. I don't really have anything, I don't want you in my bank account, but my bank account's pretty solid and I use a serious password for it. But I would be using probably multi-level authentication if I had something like this, which means I'm using a fingerprint and a passcode, a phrase, a retinal print, voice print, whatever. I'm mixing all those things together to keep you out of it. So if I had something like that, and I use these for corporate recommendations too. So sometimes at corporate levels, they're saying, yeah, this would be the end of the world if somebody accessed this file of all of our porn. that's basically the quick wrap of some website stuff, how it looks, what you should look for. So always be critical. Yeah, I'm not having a stroke. Sorry. I had to remember the word.
I smell burnt toast.
Well, that's it for me then. I was about to say always be closing, which is from Glengarry Glen Ross, is a great play by David Mamet. If you've never seen it, it's great. I got to see it with Al Pacino in it, but he was playing the old guy then. It wasn't as fun.
Yeah.
But always be critical or / cynical of websites. So when people start asking you for things, it's just like in public. If a guy walked up to you on a subway platform and they said, could you give me your mother's maiden name? You'd go, get bent. Or, pepper spray them or whatever you do to people that walk up to you on subway platforms. I'm a little more paranoid than a lot of people. But, you wouldn't. But on the internet, people ask you for things all the time, and you just give it right up. They send you an email and say, could you click here and then give me your mother's maiden name and all this, and you do. And we've talked about that in other shows. But I really you have to have that level of sort of skepticism of what you're looking at and always be thinking about that. The other piece I will give you in this, and this is a freebie. It's not on the script. Oh. We don't have a script. But there's a script here. It's free.
There's no teleprompter back here.
God knows what's up here. I do the same thing with credit cards. Have throwaway credit cards. Get a credit, because you can go today, unlike when I was like in college where you couldn't get credit cards. Today, anybody can get a credit card. My cats get credit card offers because the vet sold it. You know, it's like Reyes cat. You know, literally get a $5,000 line of credit.
Ooh.
And I'm like, wow, I should do that because I'm going to have a card for my cat.
Pixel has her own Visa.
Exactly. Pixel, yeah. Pixel's my cat that has her own Twitter feed. But get a throwaway credit card. Just the next time you get one of those credit card offers in the mail, and you just get one, you can limit. You can always lower your credit card limit.
Yep.
If you go and call the company, they never get this request, so they freak out a little, and I do it. And you call them, and you go, could you take my limit from like $2,000 and lower it down to, say, like $250? They're like, what? You want $250,000 of credit? No, like $250. And you're like, why would you want to do that? That way I don't have to worry about it.
Yeah.
And then you can have like gradiated cards.
Yep.
So you got like a really low dollar card for buying like dinky things from game sites or whatever. And that way you don't have to worry about it. They can never run the limit up more than the limit.
You could even do prepay if you wanted to.
And you could do prepay cards. So if you do a lot of risky stuff, I just don't feel like I do that much risky stuff. But if I was going to go to like really questionable sites and buy things, I might actually get prepaid cards just as burners.
Yeah, burners, like a cell phone.
But then you've got cards that you would never use on the internet because they got big limits on them or whatever. Although that's the risk on that's gotten better because the companies are really good at catching that. So we talked about the web. We talked about paranoia, credit cards, passwords. It's like everything's right here. And what were you waiting for? So, Russ, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for being here today. I'm Doug White. And we will see you next time on Secure Digital Life.
Take care.